My name is Helen Molesworth. I help out at the Underground Museum, and I organize the Noah Davis Show at the David Zorner Gallery.
Hello, my name is Karon Davis. I am an artist and co-founder of the Underground Museum, Noah's wife.
Hi, this is Kahlil Joseph. I'm Noah's brother and co-founder of the Underground Museum.
From David Zorner, this is Dialogues, a podcast about artists and the way they think.
For someone who lived to 32, such short, like, so, he did so much, so many different styles and conquered so much in his paintings.
And he was able to actually collapse how people, what art means to any art maker or art lover, and actually collapse it into the actual experience of engaging art.
It's a dream world that had all this room for all these other people's dreams too.
Mm-hmm. I'm Lucas Werner, and every episode features a conversation. We're taking artists, writers, philosophers, designers, and musicians and putting them in conversation with each other to explore what it means to make things today. This episode's guests are the curator Helen Molesworth, the artist Karon Davis, and the filmmaker Kahlil Joseph. In 2015, the artist Noah Davis passed away and left an incredible legacy, both of artworks and in the museum, the Underground Museum, which he founded in L.A. Before he had turned 32. Helen Molesworth is a renowned curator and put together a show of Noah Davis's work at one of our New York galleries, which will be traveling to the Underground Museum. Karon Davis, the artist, is also Noah's widow and co-founded the Underground Museum with him. And Kahlil Joseph is a filmmaker and is Noah's brother and has an incredible insight into Noah's practice and the way it influenced the artists around him. I thought if you're comfortable talking about that, Karon, I would really love to hear kind of how you and Noah met. I heard from Dagny yesterday, him bringing you into the bookshop at LACMA and him saying, I'm in love, to Dagny. And that made me think like it would be kind of amazing to hear sort of how that relationship materialized, how you guys got to know each other.
Well, we had met, my friend had met him in the grocery store in West Adams, and she was doing a party, like art party thing. And at the time, I was living in West Adams with about five other girls in this house, which is
this huge house.
Huge house, which is the norm. Casa La Femme, we called it.
Yes.
DJs. I mean, it was a crazy house. And they got to talking, and he's like, I'm an artist, but I don't have a studio. And she was like, well, you can come over to my house and paint in the living room. And at the time, I was working for a director, and I'd come home, and he was there. I was a workaholic. He had a girlfriend, but we stayed friends over the years.
How old were you guys back then, when you say, or how old was he?
23. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
He had just moved out.
So it was after Cooper, basically. Like, yeah.
He left Cooper early and got fed up with New York and came to LA.
He dropped out of Cooper.
And then him and I lived together, and we lived down the street from where Karon was living in that big house at the time. And my mom has always said Noah's happiest when he's painting in his whole life.
Wow.
And so when, you know, there was a lot going on at that time, too, in New York for him. 9/11 had happened.
Yeah.
And he saw it. We had been in L.A. Wow. The family had been in New York for like, they moved to New York in September 2011. Yeah. September 1st.
Oh,
it was
God.
An intense year. I remember him talking about that and how 9/11 really affected him.
Yeah, he has photos. He has very explicit photos that he took. So I think that it was a lot, and the family unit was starting to contend with itself coming to New York from Seattle. So all of that, I think, created an opportunity for him to come out west where he met Karon.
But you guys were really, what one gets from the catalog and from reading about the families, that you guys were really close as a family. I mean, your father, Kevin, it's like there was a real kind of intense closeness. That sounds like there were weekly dinners.
Well, we grew up in Seattle, and we grew up as kind of a standalone nuclear family, meaning we didn't have aunts or uncles or cousins in Seattle. My dad got a job out of college at a law firm in Seattle, so all we had was ourselves. Mm. And my mom's family's from Chicago and my dad's family's from Sacramento. Seattle's an island.
Yeah, right.
Literally and figuratively. So, yeah, I think that created a sense of closeness.
But your father was already in New York at the time.
My father was a lawyer in Seattle and his law firm expanded to New York and they asked him to head up the New York firm. Right. So the family moved and it happened to coincide perfectly with Noah's freshman year at Cooper.
Got it. Okay. So you're kind of beginning, you're in the Casa Femme and he's painting there and he has a girlfriend at the time, but you guys stay friends.
I didn't have contact with him for a while, but the painting that he made for this show for some reason ended up in my apartment. So I would always think about him. And then a few years later, I think it was around my birthday, a group of us were hanging out and he called the house and he said, oh, they're shooting off fireworks over here. It's so loud. Can I come over? And I was like, sure. And he never went home. We were just attached at the hip from that day forward.
Wow.
You know, yeah. And soon after that, we got a house together and we locked ourselves in the house and we made work and he became my teacher. And I was making films at the time and a closet artist and we were just like in our nest.
Wow. All I remember is by the time he was 25, they were married. We looked up and they were married.
You guys were married by the time?
They got married in Miami at Art Basel.
I read about that actually.
He's like, fuck this art fair. Oh, can I?
Wait, was that? I remember. I think it was for the Rebel. It was around.
It was 30 Americans.
30 Americans. He was down there, and yeah.
Yeah.
And he,
We eloped. We eloped during 30 Americans. He's like, fuck this art fair. Let's get married. And I was like, sure.
That's that photo. That's stepping into tomorrow. That's them getting married in Miami at Art Basel.
Yeah, City Hall. By a woman with purple hair, which was that sounds, like so weird.
Sounds fitting, potentially. I mean, that's something like who all was there for that? Was that like...
It was just us. Okay. Our parents were very upset that we did that. There was no wedding. But, right. You know.
But that's where he and Henry became close.
Oh, really?
Henry Taylor.
Because Henry, of course, was in this show, too. They were interacting with each other. Mm-hmm. Did you become friendly with Henry Taylor then, too? Or was it... Yes.
Yeah, well, right away... I remember we were in a taxi and Henry was on the street. Henry saw Noah's like, hey, what's going on, Noah? And I thought they had known each other for years the way that Henry was interacting with him. And Noah's like, no, I've never met him before. But and instead of going to all of the art fair functions, like we would end up in Henry's hotel room, just like drinking and smoking and having a good time. And that's what it was about because it was, you know, how the art fairs can get. So,
I mean, it sounds like it's sort of coming up, but there's a lot of talk, I think, around Noah about charisma.
And he was always just very interested in you and your dreams and what you're doing and inspiring you. And
that's true.
You know, yeah, you should do it. Oh, you want to open up a, whatever, like, do it. Do it tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, who cares what everybody says? You know?
Yeah, I think that that's right. I think my experience of Noah is that part of his charisma came from his generosity. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So he was really genuinely interested in what other people had to say, what they were doing. Mm-hmm. He was really interested in what kind of work you did and like what your artwork was, what your writing was. You know, he didn't just take it in, but then he kind of gave it back to you.
Right.
And there was something about that that you did sort of feel like when you were with him, like even though he was doing 12 things, you were the only thing he was paying attention to, you know? So it was that kind of energy too. But really I do think the charisma came in large measure, or for me, it was just really tied to the generosity and the curiosity of his spirit.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally.
And he was so genuine and real. And he would tell you things that you didn't want to hear about yourself. You know, he was very blunt.
Okay.
And I think everyone loved that about him too. He didn't hold it back at all.
What are some examples? Can you think of like brotherly examples, Kahlil? I was going to ask about this, so like brotherly dynamic.
I didn't get this. Did you get the sense that he did that? He would say that to people's face, or he would just say that about, okay, that's interesting.
I don't think he would. He would always just, he wouldn't dance around. He always had his opinion and stood by it.
Yeah. I mean, he was very mercurial, I'll be honest, and like an enigmatic, meaning you, what you're saying about him is largely accurate.
Right.
But it's not accurate in the words that you're saying. Huh. Does that make sense? Yes. Like if you were to show it based on what you're saying right now, it's not, he's actually really shy.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Like if he was here, mm-hmm. he wouldn't really be enthusiastic about what we're doing right now.
Right.
He's not like, yo, let me
no, I understand.
Talk about my,
yeah.
right.
And what I'm trying, you know, and who.
He'd turn it back on you. Right. He'd say, oh, so
exactly.
How'd you get involved in editing? Why'd you want to do these podcasts?
Right,
like,
right,
so
right.
How'd that hook up? Like, what's that mm-hmm. Simon Schuster hookup I read about? Right, like he'd any energy you brought to him, in my experience, he tended to turn back toward you in a way.
Interesting.
Like he wasn't very social, but then that's like the opposite of who he was too. Like he was very, it's like a bon vivant, but he's not like, he didn't like to travel, but he went everywhere. He's kind of a,
there's like tension. Yeah.
He's paradoxical in a lot of ways, you know?
It's interesting to hear that there was a kind of interior quietness to it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Oh, yeah. You never really saw him out like that. Huh. He'd find little pockets of people like Karon and her friends at the house.
Right.
You know? Mm-hmm. Or what ended up cultivating at the underground was a group of people that no one knew. And by extension, people that Karon and I knew.
Right.
And that was it. And even how Helen got pulled into the fray was, there was no press releases, there was no Instagram accounts, there was no...
Maybe, Helen, you can talk about that pulling into the fray. And, I remember, you know, as I was looking back at it, you said that all in, you knew him sort of 8 months, which is kind of astonishing given, I think, how deep that connection feels or seems to feel from the outside, you know?
Yeah, I met Noah in mid-September 2014, and he passes at the end of August 2015. So it's a short year for sure. And I'm always very conscious of that. And one of the reasons I think the show of the paintings at the gallery is so moving is... most of the time that I spent with Noah, we actually spent working on the underground. Like that was what he was talking about. That was where this incredible kind of time pressure, especially when, as he got sicker and and time was feeling compressed and precious, that, everything I think that he was doing with me really was about the UM and trying to secure this roadmap that he left us, which was an extraordinary roadmap.
Will you talk a little about that roadmap, what that is, that document? Because it's kind of an amazing...
Yeah, it's pretty great. You know, the way we organized the partnership was that basically I gave Noah... A three-ring binder that basically contained thumbnail images of everything in Mocha's collection and said, choose what you want. And he started just going through it and making shows. Like he was just picking objects and making these lists, making like Excel sheets. And then him and Karon started making these you were calling them prezies, like these PowerPoint presentations, you know.
With our limited skills, yes, we tried to make presentations for the underground many a times.
Right, like like this kind of rudimentary deck or PowerPoint. But it was all, and I remember once having, lunch with Kahlil and like basically like saying like, is this going to happen? Like I need to like, I kind of needed a, like, if we're going to do this, we've got to do this. You know, I need to know that, this is happening. And Karon and Noah would like, I'd go and see them in the hospital. And then, the next day that we would be working back and forth.
Laptop before the chemo kicked in, that was like, it was like this window that we would work in the hospital.
Exactly. Yeah. And they were just trying to pull all these ideas together so that basically we had a roadmap. The weird thing to me about, it's like, how much did Noah know and how much is just
this energy that sort of enveloped us at a certain point, because the way I always think about the UM and what Noah did was, I feel like there was this group of people around the space that year, and he basically asked everybody to do a certain thing. And then when he passed, we all just did the thing he'd asked us to do. and then nonfiction opened. You know what right. I mean? And then it was just like, oh, you know, like, I don't even think I really understood, like, oh, he made those collages about the garden and Leanne is doing the garden. Mm. Or like, Kahlil is like way out there with Purple Garden Cinema. Like, there's going to be this whole thing that's going to happen out mm-hmm. in the garden in the summertime. Like, in, you know, Daniel had a sense of his aesthetics, you know, and how he wanted things to be framed, you know, his sense of typography, his sense of like gold leaf, his sense of a certain kind of font style, you know, like everybody right. knew something. And then there was this collective energy, but it's not like, it wasn't like being on a team and like the coach called the play or anything. It was like, we were just out there and that it just happened. And I think that's just his, whether he did that consciously or not, in a way almost doesn't matter to me, because that is, I think, the genius of Noah as, if when I think about the underground as a work of art, yes. which I often do, that's where I see Noah's authorship almost in the biggest way, is him knowing
who to.
Yeah. And that's like, I always think about him. He's a basketball player. He played point guard, right? He's got a point guard mentality, right, like run the floor, you know, like, yeah.
Do this, yeah. We all had our marching orders. Mm-hmm.
But would you guys each have known what the other one had, or was it sort of like slightly siloed and then everyone just kind of came together and the thing happened?
I think, we all have a version of Noah that we walk around with, and we come together to bring those pieces to, there's a very real sense of dynamic leadership, if you will. So I'll be adamant about any given thing, whether it's from an artist that I think we should include in the show or how the thing, and then I could get the direct opposite kind of impulse from Karon, Helen, Anya, my mom, the director, Megan. And it's about what the group
feels.
Consciousness kind of tends towards. Wow. And it happens like that, I think, across the board, which is really beautiful. It feels, you know, like we're always trying to see, okay, well, what is Noah honor? What is Noah wanting to kind of bring to light? Like, yeah. I thought nonfiction was a really beautiful example of Noah's, how he let room for all of us to kind of participate in his vision or give life to his vision. So I don't know how many artists are in nonfiction.
Which I can't remember anymore.
11 or something.
Maybe. Yeah, it's like, that's about right. Mm. Yeah, 11.
But there's only 4 of those artworks and artists that are in Mocha's collection. So right. he organized an 11-person show from only 4 actual works.
Right.
So he wanted Kerry James Marshall and David Hammonds and Theaster Gates and Dina Lawson down the list in the show, but they weren't in Mocha's collection in terms of the works that he wanted. So we then had to go, and he wasn't at all explicit about the works from those artists that he wanted in the show. For Hammonds, he actually wanted The Hood,
right,
specifically. And we had to go out and ask David for The Hood. Because Noah.
And who was going to call? We're all like, who's going to call?
Yeah, who's going to call? Who's
that was easy. Yeah. We all just looked at Kahlil. Like, you're calling. that was a no-brainer, man.
What was that call like? Was he receptive to the whole project? He probably had heard of it already.
Well, for those who know David on any level, I think personally recognize that no amount of logic or rationale is going to win him over. It has to be some mystical set of circumstances that, and so I didn't know that because I never talked to the man. And so I was fortunate to get his phone number and he picked up, and I had, you had your elevator pitch.
Yeah, like, yeah.
I got you. This is who I am. This is what the Underground Museum is. This is who my brother was. This is what the show, it felt like an eternity, but it might have been
30 seconds.
Yeah. And he just kind of listened and said, we knew the woman who actually owned The Hood, and there was, I think, some challenge there actually, you know, of course, getting it loaned. So he said, why don't you just chop off?
He gave us permission
to just chop off another gray hood. And he told me to call it, in parentheses, gray, to find a gray hoodie, because the original, I think, is now off black.
Yeah.
And I just remember being stunned in that moment that this was going to happen, and in such a underground kind of way, if you will.
But we were so diligent. Remember, there was, like,
he told me to destroy it afterwards. I remember we burned it in some ceremonial way after.
But I don't remember who went out, but someone went out and bought like 5 different gray sweatshirts.
You guys had to pick.
Do you know what I mean? Like, it was, it's a room full of artists. So everybody was like, oh, snap. This has to be like the best cutoff hood from a sweatshirt ever.
A lot of pressure there.
Yeah, that people took it incredibly seriously.
And David knew Noah. He knew his work. He'd been to his show at Tilton. He had actually come to the Underground on Noah's birthday that year. And he had left.
Right.
Broke him out of the hospital. He didn't want to be there. And Henry bought him by the space. And there's David Hammons, his hero.
Yeah.
So again, it's like, it's always just a bit magical, mystical hell. But it all comes together.
But funny, because of course that is a sanctioned version of that imitation of wealth, of the kind of move that was made early on when he couldn't get the loan. So it's sort of like, it's very good circularity there. You know what I mean? That you have David Hammons like, do the thing that you kind of were already doing, but I'll give it the stamp of approval.
It also, I remember someone, I think probably obviously Helen called, you know, no one knew Carrie James Marshall except Helen. We were like, hey, Carrie. You know, there's this kid who did this thing, and he's like, oh, I got a couple of things kicking around the studio. And they were, you know, of course, perfect for the show. And Dita Lawson had just made this incredible masterpiece out in Africa that had yet to be shown. And
Bob Gober lent the wallpaper.
Noah wrote this amazing letter to Bob Gober.
Yeah. So I had known Bob. Noah really wanted the wallpaper. And we sent Bob Noah's email. And Bob, as you know, is very particular about the work and agreed to, I mean, he sent the wallpaper for free. And Noah had asked us to put on top of the wallpaper this like WPA era photograph by a Czechoslovakian female photographer named Marian Falfi. That was taken in January, like 1942 or something. It was the first widow, the first lynch victim's widow of that year.
Wow.
So it's a African-American woman headshot, you know, very, you know, her face is etched in pain, you know, pain and disbelief and, you know, all of the things that would attend, we can imagine would attend such a violent form of loss. And I took a photograph of it and sent it to Bob because I knew Bob was so particular. I wanted to make sure that, you know, Bob would also be okay. And Bob wrote us an email that he had never, that never before had the wallpaper been installed in a way that had really realized it, and that this was that moment. So I do think that's sort of back to that generosity of Noah. I mean, I think he made a space for other artists. Mm. And I feel like when other artists come into that space, they both take the liberty that the space offers, but also elevate their game to the level of the offer in a way. Right. So like Dina Lawson and Rodney McMillan made extraordinary shows there that I don't know if they could have made in their own gallery spaces. Right. You know, I mean, I think they're like, it's like when you play chess or tennis with somebody better than you, you know, you kind of, you bring something to that table. And I feel like that's one of the things that happens at the Underground.
I also realized I was relatively new to the inner workings of art exhibition or making, of course. And so I got the sense that Noah's originality and vision as a curator was really evident. like the hanging of the photo on top of another work. I remember Helen being like, that's against the rules. You just don't do that. In my line of work, we don't do that. And for Bob
to come back and be like, he got it.
He got it. He actually, by breaking the rules, he actually nailed it. Or I don't know if it's that simple, but the genius of his curatorial vision was really part of the fabric of what makes shows at the Underground, especially his shows, because we now have done certain shows that weren't necessarily part of that original charter of Noah's vision, but we always, you know, are thinking about.
But he left a list of people.
Exactly. So, like the Rodney,
About that first show, I think, am I getting the title right? The Imitation of Wealth?
Imitation of Wealth, right?
So what, can someone take me through, like, what, I mean, he asked for a bunch of loans of kind of serious art, didn't get them, and then just, how did you guys, Karon, how did you guys make them?
People would come into the space. He asked museums, he asked galleries, he asked collectors. And people are like, you're crazy. We're not bringing this work to that neighborhood. Like, what are you talking about? So he looked up at the fluorescent lights that were hanging in the space and the light bulb went off. He's like, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take down these lights. We're going to get some gels. We're going to make some damflavins. We're going to, he wanted to do the Jeff Koons piece.
Didn't you source the vacuum cleaner?
I sourced the vacuum cleaner that day on Craigslist. I drove to the Valley to get this vacuum cleaner and it was exact.
The one.
It was the one. And what are the odds that that day he came up with it? It was just like, we did it. And then I had to like bring it back and scrub it up and get it all nice. And
right.
it was all dirty.
Jeffify it.
Yeah. And that's where the show began.
But that show must have gotten people's attention.
No, it didn't. No one cared.
At that point, it was just the neighborhood and friends that were coming to the Underground. Like people that knew it, like it was really underground.
Yeah, it was like Noah's experiment for himself and for people who were in the, you know, who just happened to catch it. You could tell he was working through his ideas that became the Underground. Now there are these legendary kind of shows, but at the time, I remember the LA Weekly maybe wrote a little tiny
something, but she was also a friend. Yeah.
She's a friend.
But even the Oracle was still kind of on the
DL. No, the Oracle
wasn't it? Yeah, I think.
Yeah, that's fair.
I mean, that's compared to what happened, the Oracle was still.
Fair. It was all kind of a prelude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was working stuff out.
Yeah. And he would often. At that point, he had fired his gallery and he was just selling work out of the Underground.
Right.
And he was, as Kahlil said, working through ideas. And so lots of time, the neighborhood, they got to see a Noah Davis show that nobody else saw. So,
and it's in those early shows that he pushed Karon and I to make work.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Kind of, totally. I think he simultaneously believed in us to make work that belonged in that space, but also he needed work.
Right. He needed to put something in his space.
Yes.
And he was being resourceful in the same way Imitation of Wealth was this pure invention and resourcefulness. Yeah. It was also like, I got my brother and my wife who are extremely creative and in the process, you know, like here, because my studio was at the Underground at that point and Karon was living there with, obviously. So it was just like, he just literally turned to both of us.
Yeah. He's like, you're doing a show in 2 weeks. You got 2 weeks because this is how we're going to do it. And I was like,
And that's where, Helen said, Daniel DeJure came in, who is still
production.
Everything. He looked at Daniel and was like, how do I make a world-class exhibition? How do I make this look like an exhibition for two pennies and a nickel?
Wow.
And Daniel was like, I got you.
Wow. Can I go back? I kind of want to hear how you guys started first talking about the Underground Museum, Karon. He was a painter. You guys were making work together. Obviously, you said you were kind of nesting in your home for a while. At what point did the kind of nest give birth to?
Well, I think it would start with Kevin because he was so generous and would always give money and remind Noah at the end of the year, like, got to give back. And so I think he instilled that in the boys, would you say? Yeah. And his also love for real estate. Mm. And we would always just go around the neighborhood. West Adams is the oldest neighborhood in Los Angeles, and you have these beautiful craftsman homes. And we would go into these homes and dress up and knew that we had not a dime,
right.
but just dream about creating space to show film and art and bringing people together in a bit of an art club. Like, we were just throwing around all these ideas. And then Kevin got sick, and I think you can take it from here, Kahlil, because there were conversations Kevin was having with you and Noah when he was getting treatment about what to do as a family.
Yeah. When our father was kind of, he got really sick, and so Noah and I were in New York for that moment. And, you know, there's a, towards the end of one's life, you start, a lot starts to come out.
Yeah.
So my dad was like, I want you guys to start a space for the, you know, in the community. It's going to have coffee and it's going to be about arts and it's going to be all these things. And I remember Noah and I just like, what are you talking about?
Right.
Like, sure. And so we started writing down all these ideas that included, and he passed and we moved back to California. And, you know, that whole process like that, for anyone who's been through it, is you got to contend with a lot of like, that's that idea just kind of got, I don't want to say lost at all, but, you know, we're dealing with estate, wrapping family, up estate, all this kind of stuff. Yeah. Medical bills, whatever those conversations are. Yeah. But my father left us both inheritance, and my brother used that inheritance almost entirely, I think.
Yeah. No, he was very clear about this is not our money. This is for the community. This is what we're going to do.
But it was, I'll be honest, like, I think there was a consciousness that Noah had that he was fulfilling a version of my father's
dreams, of course.
But it was also very much Noah's dream.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So that's kind of it was both simultaneously. Does that make sense?
Yes. And to honor Kevin. So the Purple Garden was, you know, he would spend a lot of time out there. And I feel the underground was a healing project for him. Like, he just threw it all into that, you know, and it was all about Kevin. It was all about that.
I mean, it's amazing because it has, as a space and as I would get a cultural entity, it has the energy of a kind of dream, or I guess of a double dream.
Just again, to go back to what for me is one of the salient characteristics of Noah, is that it's a dream world that had all this room for all these other people's dreams too.
Mm-hmm.
So, like what happened at the opening of Nonfiction, where like 1,000 people came, and it was an opening that began in the daytime and went through to the evening. So it was this like families with young children from noon to 3, and then like these kind of hipster types at dusk, and then like even hipper types once the sun went down for dancing, and this evolution of a crowd that just kept growing, and everyone showed up. First off, everyone shows up for underground events like so correct. Like, people just look
amazing,
so beautiful. And I think also in the wake of, you know, the current political situation or cultural situation we find ourselves in, just people wanted to be in a space where, I think everybody wanted to be in Black space. And I think like it was Black space, and those were the terms of engagement. And then it was open, and it felt like a gift. Like, it always feels like a gift that lots of people. And like, you know, a gift demands to be reciprocated, right? That's part of the logic of the gift. And I feel like when everybody shows up correct and everybody shows up with all their A-game energy, like that's part of what they're doing at an opening almost. It's like they come to reciprocate the generosity. And that just creates this sort of, it's like a wave. It's like the tide goes out, the tide comes in. Like, you can count on that love energy at the UM all the time.
It feels like art in the big everybody loves art sense, like fashion or something, is what you experience when you go to meet art, quote unquote, at the museum or a gallery doesn't quite live up to the feeling that it has inside your heart, into your head as a young person or anybody who loves art. And I think Noah started to really recognize that, and he was able to actually collapse how people, what art means to any art maker or art lover, and actually collapse it into the actual experience of engaging art.
So as opposed to having a distanced reaction, like a kind of you're being held at arm's length, you're having the kind of proper emotional sort of affective
living
reaction.
With the art.
Living with the art.
Yes.
Well, look, I mean, one way, like the simplest way to say it is like nobody is networking at a UM event. You know, like nobody is doing that. And
you might meet your wife though.
Or partner. Oh yeah. I'm sure there's many baby underground there's, babies.
Oh, yeah. I think yeah,
oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah,
there's
oh,
many
yeah, for sure.
And some of it too, I think, is chalked up to Noah always wanting to make everything free.
Yeah.
So immediately when you walk in, no matter who you are, there's the idea of a market, the idea of who's hot or whatever those conversations might be. We're not asking of a transaction in any way at any point in that experience.
Yeah.
You feel that in terms of fine art, any other space, whether it's a museum or gallery, it's very clear that everything around you is very expensive. You could have a $1 million painting on the wall, but you won't have that feeling at the underground.
Can I ask these two guys a question? So, because I see, you know, I talk to Karon all the time, and we see each other, you know, relatively frequently in LA, and we work on the UM. But these pictures are up now. These paintings are up. Mm. And you're both seeing things you haven't probably seen in a long time, even though you both live with Noah's work in your own homes, and Noah's work hangs in the back room at the UM. So I'm curious what this moment is like for you at the level of the paintings, because I feel like I know our various stories about the UM, you know, but how are you feeling about Noah, the painter, Noah, that part of his practice, and seeing those pictures and this kind of presentation at the gallery, which is so
beautiful.
So beautiful, so bespoke in every way, you know. I mean, it's the reverence with which that gallery treats artwork is very, you can really feel it. And I'm curious what that feels like to you, what the paintings, what were you surprised by? You know, just what's this like for you now?
I'm blown away by the cohesiveness of these kind of intangible quotients I can't even sometimes put my finger on. So it's not like, oh, you know, techniques or anything. It's like these other layers that I would glimpse in one-off paintings. But, you know, it's in many ways, it's kind of like a survey, you know, it's ahistorical. It's not work he just made in the last 6 months or something. But one, I guess the highlight from, you know, I'm partial. I'm like Karon, obviously. I'll unpack what her experience has been. But I've always felt he was like the best.
That's what I was about to say.
Yeah.
Noah was a motherfucking genius. And now New York and everybody gets to experience. And no, that's how I feel. It's like, if you don't know, now you know.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, we all knew he was something special and is something special, you know. But seeing it all together, I'm sorry, Khalil,
no,
you can go.
No.
But seeing it all together and being able to share it with everybody and share it with Moses, who's 10 now, and he doesn't remember the show at the Astors, and seeing his energy around it.
But one of the highlights, I mean, I think he's always known his dad was famous too, but now it's like, oh.
Yeah.
My dad was really famous.
No, when you see like the amount of like fuss, you know, it's like 50 people sort of all
right,
you know,
yeah.
For a kid, that's kind of an amazing thing.
Yeah, you know, the handlers and all that stuff. Yeah,
he took his shoes off right away, which I knew that I was like, okay, this is the right place because he feels at home. He feels like, he even said, this feels like the underground. This feels like home. And
One of the highlights was Chris O'Feely came when we were installing with David Adage. To see the work. And I've never met Chris. I know Noah never met Chris. You know, I think Noah and I love Chris's work. And to walk around, Chris was very, one of the galleries where the works were being installed was closed with tape and plastic. You got to paint in the floors or something. And he just burst in the room like, that don't mean nothing. Yeah, to him, he needed to see the paintings. And I kind of shadowed. They're close friends, David and Chris. And so both, you know, majestic geniuses in their own right. And they were walking around and spending about 10 minutes each with each work, which is and kind of unpacking and commenting and riffing on the humor. And, you know, it was like, I almost wanted to cry. It was amazing because it was, you could tell there was an immense, they weren't doing it for me. They weren't being, you know, generous in their appreciation. They were just, you know, they first time seeing his work, I could tell. And so that was, that's something that I didn't, I won't say expect, but I couldn't have expected to hear another painter really help me see things I never even, I was looking at paintings I've seen for years and I was literally seeing things I never, like right in front of your face.
Yeah.
Kind of things. Can you imagine? It's like someone telling you there's someone in a painting that wasn't even, you know, I didn't even notice that guy or the expression on his face or
their there's no shadows. You were, Helen, you were talking about the shadows, but then on the Lenny Breve install, there's this shadow, which Chris was like, that looks like a bamboo, bamboo. Mm-hmm. Sorry. And I was like, wow. And I had to go back and look at it and I was like, oh my God, yeah, that is a bamboo.
And Chris kept saying, you know, there's more than one painting in this painting.
Yep.
Which is, you know, maybe something that painters are, a conversation that painters always have with each other. You know what I mean? That's happening on a technical level, but I didn't. I'm just kind of, as a storyteller, I'm getting this, but I got it in a way that I was like, geez, man, this is amazing.
I mean, that the question that raises is that overpainting question, which more than one painting in a painting.
Oh, it was heartbreaking.
Yeah, there's so many paintings that are...
Can you imagine like someone like recording a masterpiece song and then deleting it and just using the tape to record another song? It's like,
why would you do that? We should be clear for our audiences. Yeah. So like what would happen is Noah would paint a bunch of paintings and people would see them. And then almost everybody who knows Noah well has the story of they see a bunch of paintings. They think, oh my God, that's amazing. They go back 2 days later and they've all been painted over.
So yeah. Also for our audience.
That was the other thing. There was a kind of scorched earth, like, you know.
But for our audience to be clear, every painting they'll see in the show, there's other paintings behind those paintings.
Definitely.
All of them. It's not, it's like there's these sedimented layer stories that are completely hidden. I mean, you'd have to.
He would paint over them for different reasons. Sometimes it's because we couldn't afford canvases and these were the paintings that came back from the show that didn't sell. And fuck it, I'm just going to paint over them because we just need the money, you know. Sometimes it's like, damn, I can't get that face, the face.
Yeah. Yeah,
I couldn't get the face right.
But it would
just get rid of it.
I mean, I'm sure Karon has way more pictures in her head of paintings I've been painting over than I do. But I mean, the ones that I remember are just like
the B-sides. That'll be one.
But I thought Henry Taylor talks about it. And I thought Henry had a great account of it because I'm not a painter and I'm not an artist. So like it is the song moment. I can't imagine writing 70 pages and then like getting to the end and being like, ah, fuck it. Delete. You know, like I just can't. I don't have the ego for that, you know. But Henry said that he thought it was like this, like no complacency, no boredom, like constant striving. So like you stand at the free throw line, you see how many free throws you can do in a row. You do whatever, 108. Then you miss one. Got to go back.
Right.
To see if I can do 109, right? Definitely. Like this kind of constant sense of virtuosity and one-upmanship with oneself.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Right. I mean, I think that's so we're all describing this heartbreak. And Henry was like, man.
He didn't care.
He called me on it. He was like, that's your heartbreak, honey.
That's
about you in the picture. Noah wasn't ever like, oh.
I should have kept never.
Noah had no heartbreak. Noah had, if it can be that good and I made it that easily, it could be better.
Yeah, the bar for himself was so high. Right. I mean, you see it with Underground. I mean, his attention to detail, every little, seam and every little kind of nook and cranny, every corner. It's like if it was off an inch, she would go crazy.
Yeah.
And Helen did such a beautiful job curating the show and really the breadth of his work and the different styles and how he would steal people but make it his own. And this is this period, like, for someone who lived to 32, such short, like, so he did so much, so many different styles and conquered so much in his paintings.
The kind of last question I sort of wanted to ask about Kahlil was just a little bit about the dynamic growing up. I mean, and again, if it's too personal, we don't have to go there, but like, you know, both your relationship with Noah as a young person, as a creative young person who basically said he was a painter the time he was 17, he was like, that's what I'm doing, right? I mean, I feel like it happened pretty early for him. And also, I guess, the creative conversation that you guys did or didn't have growing up.
I think the creative conversation was largely unspoken, I'll be honest. Mm. I remember when Noah got into Cooper Union. We were in San Francisco with my dad for the NBA All-Star game of all things. And my dad and Noah were like, he got into Cooper Union. I mean, I remember thinking like, what the fuck is Cooper Union? Like, I sound like a community college or something, you know?
It is.
Yeah.
And they're like,
And the story goes, Noah was kind of reluctant to apply to university. This wasn't his thing. And so apparently Cooper Union came to Seattle and did one of those college things where there's a bunch of universities lined up and you can go. Yeah. And Noah brought my mother. This is how the story goes. My brother told Noah to bring his notebook. And apparently Noah got in to Scooper just on his notebook.
You just flashed the notebook there in the moment, basically.
Yeah. It was basically like, this kid is fucking, he belongs in our school. Like, this,
wow.
You know, he wasn't going to go study like, economics or something. This is not going to happen.
Well, his technical facility is so
crazy.
Yeah. I mean, the sense of composition, the sense of palette. I mean, the fluidity of the drawn line, the collage aesthetic. I mean, all of those things are in place in a young, I mean, and I don't, you know, I know Noah from 31 to 32 and still I found his skills, you know, to exceed most other people's skills. I mean, it just, he had that thing.
And he always had like a really good sense of history. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, history is vast. And so you almost need good taste and understanding history. Like what you know is worth.
What's worth the time spending on.
Harping on, what's worth remembering, what's worth continuing, you know. And I remember at a young age, it always seemed like it was that book or that period in history or that thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Karon will tell you, he was one of the reasons the Underground and his curation is so good is because his understanding of our history was so on point.
Right. Mm-hmm. You can feel that. It's living and breathing. I mean,
come on, man. It was uncanny. Like his ability to be an art historian and his appreciation for stuff.
Yeah. Also, I love artists, and great artists often are totally non-hierarchical, you know, in their thinking, like Rothko alongside whoever.
Absolutely.
It's just like whatever moves you in an organic way. And that's always a really beautiful thing.
Absolutely.
And that's how he curated the shows from the MoCA collection is if the work is good, then you belong on the wall.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he didn't care who made it.
Who made it, you know?
Guys, Kahlil, Helen, Karon, thank you so much for being here today and being part of this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dialogues is produced by David Zwerner. You can find out more about the artists on this series by going to davidzwerner.com/dialogues. And if you liked what you heard, please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. It really does help other people discover the show. I'm Lucas Werner. Thanks so much for listening, and I hope you join us again next time.